Praise the Lord, saints. Want to just say thank God for being here today and allow me to see another day. I'm extremely grateful this morning because God has been good to me. And I believe and trust that God has been good to you as well. I'm excited about going into this new year because the Lord has dropped in my spirit that when I cross over to the new year, to 2017, there are some things that have been troubling me and that's been following me and that's been with me for maybe 10 years or so that have just been a troublesome and a burden and a weight on my spirit. But while I was in prayer some weeks ago, God assured me that as I go into 2017, that there would be some things that would not be crossing over with me. And I began to celebrate and thank God for that, because it's going to mark a new beginning. And I'm just excited about what God is doing in my life. And I know that God is no respecter person, that he's going to do the same thing for you. I believe that some of you, when you cross over into the new year, that there will be some things in your life that will not cross over with you. I believe just like God had defeated the children, just like God had defeated the Egyptians and told the children of Israel, the enemy you shall see no more, I believe God is doing the same thing for you, because he has no respect of person. What he does for one, he will do the same thing for you. I want to come to you again today as we're going to do the right thing. The telecast is Do the Right Thing. And I want to, I just want to welcome you to Do the Right Thing. The pastor and founder is Pastor Shirley Wharton. I am your host, Elder Ronnie Stevens. You can watch Do the Right Thing every Sunday morning from 8 to 8:30 on Comcast TV 20. We can also be viewed on demand by bgntv.gospel.com 24/7, brought to you by the Bell Global Network. Say that again, Bell Global Network. Got to say that a little slow. That's a tongue tie right there. You can come out and you can have service with us at 17360 West 8 Mile Road, Southfield, Michigan, 48075. Amen. Today, as we get into the Word of God, there's some things that, there's something I would like to read to you first that the Lord had gave me. While I was in prayer December 20th, the time was 6:17 a.m. And what the Lord showed me was this. I want to read this in your hearing. I saw the great deceiver in the form of a general. Once well respected, his deceit was so obvious, but the level of deceit was so strong and persuasive. People who had one time seen this leader before his conversion were stricken with grief, because they witnessed the change that had taken place. His behavior became radical. Patience and assurance were suddenly replaced with paranoia and with apprehension. We were all standing on the seashore as he began to speak. Stars fell from the sky, hit the earth, and penetrated the earth immediately, burning its way to the very core of the earth. The earth was dark, and tidal waves started rushing toward the seashore. Now, this is something God had showed me in a dream, and I got up and I began to write it down, and the Lord also gave me the interpretation of the dream. It said that the great deceiver represents the false prophet. It represents the false prophet. Now, his spirit is already in operation. So the Lord has let me know that the spirit of the false prophet is already in operation. That's the great deceiver. The one-time general that walked in such level of leadership, such high level of leadership lacked the power of the Holy Spirit, okay, to withstand the wiles of the devil, thus falling victim to the influence of the false prophet. So the one-time general that one time had walked with respect, it's saying here that was a man of God, that walked with God once before, did not have the he didn't have the power, he didn't have enough power from the Holy Spirit to withstand the wiles of the devil. And thus he fell victim to the false prophets. In other words, at one time this man or this woman walked with God, had an influence on people, loved the Lord, but lacked the power thereof. And as a result, then the spirit of the false prophet was able to overtake that individual and mislead others. The disappointed people were who were the followers of the general that had admired him at one time. These were the people in the congregation that at one time knew that woman or man of God and knew that they were the man and woman of God, but they were in awe when they seen the transformation take place. The fallen stars represent other preachers and teachers. And the change in the earth's atmosphere, the dark skies and the tidal waves, they represent the repercussions of the false prophet's teaching. We're in a time now where the spirit of the false prophet is here. And you're going to have to arm yourselves and be ready to do what God has told you to do. The title of today's message is Press. Now, I don't think I'm going to get through this whole thing, but it's press. It's press your way. If you're going to do what God has called you to do today, if you're not going to be one of the ones that fall victim to the false prophet, you're going to have to press your way. I got an acronym for press. I have an acronym for the word press. An acronym for press is simply pray, resist, endure, study, and stand. Let me say that again. The acronym for the word press is to pray, resist, endure, study, stand. Prayer, I want you to write this scripture down. If you got a pen, you want to write these scriptures down. In the book of Ephesians 6 and 18, it says praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. So we are to pray. Second thing we are to do is God requires us, we have to resist the enemy. In James 4 and 7, the Bible says, submit yourself unto God, resist the devil, and he will flee. Say that again. Submit yourself unto God. James 4 and 7. Submit yourself unto God. Resist the devil and he will flee. The other one is endure. In 2 Timothy 2 and 2 Timothy, the second chapter, the third verse. Therefore, endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. So you're going to have to endure. And then we're going to have to study. 2 Timothy 2:15. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And then finally, is stand. It may be well with you. That it may be well with you. Having done all to stand, therefore stand in the liberty with which Christ have set you free. So then the acronym is PRESS. If you're going to make it today, you're going to have to press your way in. You're going to have to pray. You're going to have to resist. You're going to have to endure. You're going to have to stand your way in because the spirit of the false prophet is already out there and active. A lot of people are falling away and giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devil. They're walking away from what they've known to have been the right way, the word of God, to do what they want to do. I want you to turn with me to the book of 1 Timothy 4 and 1. 1 Timothy 4 and 1, you're going to find these words. It says, now the Spirit speaks expressly. that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devil. The Bible is saying here, this is what Paul had, the Bible is saying here, Paul had told Timothy here that in the latter times that there's going to be a great falling away. And that a lot of people are going to, they're going to be given in to seducing spirits and doctrines of devil. Seducing spirits, those demonic spirits, either directly or through false teachers, and we're going to be talking about false teachers, who have wandered away from the truth and lead others to do the same. The most defining word to describe the entire operation of Satan and his demons is deception. There is a spirit of deception that is in the land today. The Bible says there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end is death. It leads to death. And we want to talk about the spirit of deception, how this spirit has crept into the world, has crept in. The gateway for this spirit of deception is this: self-centeredness, disobedience, lust, and an unrepentant heart. Let me say that again. The gateway or the portal for the spirit of deception is self-centeredness, disobedience, lust, and unforgiveness. 2 Timothy 3:2 says this: for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blaspheming, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. They're going to get to a point to where they become proud and lifted up in them all, and they're going to become proud and they're going to be lifted up. They're going to be lifted up. And now note here, we're not talking about so much the world. I'm talking about people that at one time walked with the Lord and then decided not to walk with God. Okay, because we could use King Saul for an example. The Bible said at one time Saul was small in his own eyes, but when God began to use him, and as he began to elevate and God used him, at some point he stopped believing on God and trusting in himself. At some point he became disobedient to God and started leaning on his own righteousness. When the prophet Samuel came to Saul and told Saul to go in and to destroy the Amalekites, he gave him specific instructions: go in there and destroy everything, and don't take none of the spoils, none of the goods, but destroy everything. Well, Saul did the very exact opposite of what he was told to do. He held on to some of what he thought was some of the nicer things. He didn't destroy the king, held on to some of the goods, some of the money, and some of the cattle. So then he didn't do what God had told him to do. But at one time, that same Saul was so obedient, he did everything that God told him to do. But something happened to Saul that caused him to start walking in the spirit of disobedience. Of disobedience and self-centeredness. So then that goes to tell us that even though God is using us, I'm talking to the preachers today, talking to the teachers, talking to the leaders, even though God uses us, we still have to remain prayerful and we still have to fast and pray, and our highest position should be no further than the feet of Jesus, lest we too become exalted and lifted up and start thinking that we brought these things about, start believing in our own self and not believing in God. That's why Jesus, our perfect example, when Jesus was on the earth, every time he ministered, when he got done ministering, first thing he would do, he would find somewhere to pray. He would go in the wilderness to find somewhere solitude to pray. When God get finished using you, stop running around people and hanging out with this one and going there and having fun and patting yourself on the back. Find you somewhere to pray and ask God to pour back into you what you just poured out, so that God can continue to replenish you, so that you won't fall victim to that spirit of deceit, having you think that you are the one. The party can't start till you get there. The service can't start till you get there because of what God has done for you. Don't become a victim to that spirit of deceit. Don't become a victim to the spirit of deceit. Other thing we talked about was lust. Here's another portal. It's lust. I want to read this to you in James, the first chapter, the 12th through the 15th verse. It says this. It says, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to him that loveth him. And now here's the thing that I want you to get right here. Let no man, when he is tempted, say, I am tempted of God, for God cannot tempt with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But here it is right here. Catch this. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Let me say that again. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Okay? Then lust, when it has conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, it brings forth death. So lust is another one of the portal holes. It's a portal to the, it's a portal hole for the spirit of deceit to creep in. You will find that a lot of times that we're always warring and lusting against something. But whenever you find yourself giving in to lust, it's not that God has deceived, it's not that God is tempting you. It's not that God is trying you. This is not a test, but you're being drawn away of your own lust. And if you don't do anything about it, you're going to find yourself in a bad state of mind there. So one of them is lust. Then you've got the unrepentant heart. I want you to go with me to 2 Corinthians 10 and 13. It says this. It says, they have no temptation taking you, such as common unto man, but God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you are able to bear. But with all temptations, always will make a way of escape for you to bear it. So even though lusts come in, even though you're tempted by lust, God has a way of escape. But now this is the key right here. I'm finding, and it's true, that a lot of people don't want to escape. A lot of people, they don't want to be delivered. You're going to find there's a lot of people, they don't mind God taking this and taking that, but there's certain things that people want to hold on to. Just like King Saul, there were certain things that King Saul wanted to hold on to because of his own lust, because of his own desire, out of his disobedience. Even though God told him to do one thing and kept telling him to do one thing and kept encouraging him to do that one thing, he decided to go about it altogether different and run his own program. And you have to be careful. You have to be careful about that man of God. You have to be careful about that woman of God. You have to be careful about that, sir. You that are sitting out in the invisible audience, you have to be careful about that, because God has given you specific, detailed instructions on what to do so that you can be delivered, and God wants to bring you out, and that's what God desires, to bring you out. But you have decided that I'm going to pick and choose what I'm going to give to God and what I'm going to keep, and then we want to know, where's the power? We want to know, why isn't it working for me? We want to know, why is it working for somebody else and not working for me? Where if you walk in obedience and do what God has called you to do, you can experience the same deliverance, the same experience that your brother and sister have that is walking up right before Christ. But we want to take shortcuts. We don't want to do everything God has called us to do. We want to hold on to those secret sins. And that's the very thing God is going after, is the secret sin. Because if you don't give him that secret sin, you're going to fall victim to the things that are coming on this earth. And one of them is the false prophet. Is the false prophet. One of the things that the false prophet does is that if they decide that they don't want to walk up right before the Lord, they'll start justifying. They'll try to justify reasons of why they do what they want to do. They'll start leading people astray. They'll start telling people what thus saith the Lord, but they're going to distort the word of God. They're going to change the word of God to fit their situation. And you'll be surprised how many people now that are reading this Bible and then they don't want to feel convicted, so they read parts of the Bible, and the other parts that they're reading, they're trying to take the Word of God and bring it down to their level and bring it down to their way of life so that they can feel comfortable. We've got churches that are packed out, but nobody's talking about sin. We got churches that are busting over, busting through the seams, but as long as nobody's talking about sin, it's okay. But I have to tell you that if you had better get your life right with God, because if your life is not right with God, you're not going to make it in. And you're going to fall victim to the false prophet. You're going to fall victim to false teaching. You're going to fall victim. And then the Bible says, if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall in the ditch. Both are going to fall in the ditch. So he says here, if you find yourself. You don't want to be found there. You don't want to be found there. Again, these are this is the gate. This is the gateway. This is the portal for the spirit of deception. Self-centeredness, disobedience, lust, and an unrepentant heart. I want you to go with me to the book of Romans. Let's see what Romans have to say about that. Romans 1 and 21. We're going to start there. We'll start there. It says, because that they knew God. I want you to get this. They knew God. I'm talking about those of us that knew God. They knew God and they glorified him not. They knew God and they glorified him not, and neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into the image made like corruptible man, and birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobated mind. Somebody say reprobated. Gave over to a reprobated mind. What is a reprobated mind? It means to refuse, is refuse to accept. You just gonna walk in disobedience. I sent my word, but you're gonna reject it. I tried to help you, but you're going the opposite direction. I'm trying to tell you the truth, but you decide to walk away from the truth. I'm trying to get you, I'm trying to save you, but you don't want to be saved. I'm trying to pull you out, but you don't want to be poured out. Reprobated mind, it refuse to accept. Another thing, it's a sinner that is predestined for damnation. Let me say that again. A sinner that is predestined for damnation. God has been trying to reach you. He's been doing everything that he can to reach you and pull you in. It's a dangerous thing to keep refusing God. The Bible says, in the day that you hear my voice, don't you harden your heart. You keep hardening it. You keep walking away. You're walking in disobedience. You're self-centered. You're giving in to your own lust. You don't have a repentant heart. You're going to continue to do things your own way until finally what God does, according to the book of Romans in that first chapter, he said, okay, I'm going to turn you over to your own desires. I'm going to turn you over to your own flesh. I'm going to turn you over to whatever it is that you just got to have. I'm going to turn you over to it, and I'm going to let that thing, whatever that device is, have its way. A lot of times we look at Romans, the first chapter, and we think that God is just talking about homosexuality, but it's bigger than just homosexuality. Whatever God has been trying to pull you out of and deliver you from, and you consciously reject, and you consciously rebuke, and you consciously run away from, at some point God's going to turn you over to that thing. With the understanding, hoping maybe that if he turned you over to it, then you will see that, okay, God, this is not what I want. Hopefully, you'll begin to cry out to God. Hopefully, you'll decide to turn and run back to God. I kind of liken sin as this. Of course, the Bible says that the pleasures sin does have pleasure. It was Moses that said that I would rather suffer the affliction with the children of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for only a season. So sin in itself can be pleasurable. But I liken it to this. Have you ever been tickled? Somebody tickled you, and while they were tickling you, it was fun at first, and you started laughing. But the more they continue to tickle you, your stomach muscles begin to tighten up. And as your stomach muscles begin to tighten up, it's almost like your stomach is starting to cramp on you now. And even though you're laughing, it's starting to hurt. And the more they do it, you want them to stop. You're laughing, but you're really hurting on the inside. That's how sin is. In the beginning, it's fun. After a while, you're still laughing, but you're hurting on the inside. So when God turns you over to that thing, you're laughing and hurting. You're laughing and hurting. And then hopefully and prayerfully that it's not too late before you decide to cry out unto God. Who am I talking to today? Don't you fall victim to the spirit of the false prophet that's out there. I know they're telling you now that once you get saved, you're always saved. That's not true. If that was true, then Paul wouldn't have left word for the ministers when he said that I can preach the word of God and others be saved, but I myself can become a castaway. If I could be once in, if I could get saved and accept Christ at one time, and that's it, then I can go out here and live any old kind of way and preach to others, and y'all make it in, and I don't, somebody have to explain that scripture to me. Once God saves you, it's free, but you have a responsibility to maintain that salvation. God is requiring you to press. You should be praying. Me and I always pray and not faint. If you're going to make it during this hour, if you're going to make it during this hour, this time of deceit, this time where the false prophet spirit has been released and he's deceiving many, not only deceiving the world, but people in the church. The Bible says there's going to be a great falling away. Don't you become a part of that great falling away. The only way you're going to make it is you're going to have to press. This is pressing times. You're going to have to press. You're going to have to read that word of God. Get in that Bible and read. If you read your word, you're going to see what the enemy is doing. You're going to see what Jesus is saying. Don't be fooled by what you hear. Don't fall victim to what you hear. There's a false prophet coming. There's a false prophet coming. You're going to have to resist the devil. Resist the devil. Submit yourself unto God. Resist the devil and he will flee. You're going to have to study the word of God. Study to show thyself approved unto God. You got to study that word so that you'll see it. And then having done all of that, you're going to have to stand. Make a stand for God. Stand up for righteousness. If you're out there today and you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, I want to encourage you and challenge you to make that stand today. I want you to stand now and I want you to give your life over to Christ. The Bible says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Father God, I thank you, Lord, and I'm going to ask God that you would forgive me. I want you to repeat after me, Lord God, forgive me of every sin that I've committed. I thank you for this day. I thank you, Lord, because you raised Jesus from the dead. I thank you because he died for my sins. I believe that, God, that you raised him from the dead, and I believe that I'm saved. And just like that, you are saved. Now, let me encourage you to get into a Bible-believing church. Bible-believing church. And get into that word and pray, because the spirit of deception, the false prophet, his spirit is already in the land, and you don't want to become victim to that spirit. God bless you. We love you. Enjoy. Love you.
Thomas Hitman Hearn, and you're watching Bell Global Network.
What's up, everybody? This is your girl, Vicky Winans, and you're watching Bell Global Network.
My name is Mike Duggan, and I'm watching the Bell Global Network.
Hey, keep it locked. It's your boy, D. Hattie, watching the Bell Global Network. You know how it is.
Hi, I'm Charlie Langton, and you're watching the Bell Global Network. Hi, this is Martha Reeves, and you're watching Bell Global Network.
Hi, everybody. I'm telling you, everything that happened to me that was good, God did it. I'm Evelyn Turrentine, AG, and you're watching the Bell Global Network.
This is Pastor D. Alexander Bullock, the Preachers of Detroit, and you're watching the Bell Global Network.
This is Bishop Edgar Vann of Second Ebenezer Church in Detroit, Michigan, and you're watching the Bell Global Network.
Hi, I'm Bernadette Stannis. You know me best as Thelma from the TV show Good Times, and you are watching Bell Global Network.